With me now is a panel with great insight into all these issues. Joining us is General Peter Chiarelli, the former Vice Chief of Staff of the Army, who spent 7 years here on this Army post. Nicholas Schmidle, a writer for The New Yorker, who's written so powerfully about post-traumatic stress. And Congressman John Carter, who represents this district of Fort Hood. General Chiarelli, I want to talk to you first about this, because you dealt so much with post-traumatic stress, traumatic brain injuries, suicides when you were in the Army. This one has to hit hard. And what does it say to you?
Well, they all hit hard. And this is a horrible, horrible tragedy. I think even a bigger tragedy would be if the public at large came to the conclusion that everyone who returns from Iraq or Afghanistan who served in the military has these issues. We've got to understand the vast majority of our servicemen and women have been on multiple deployments, and return home unscathed.
But can you have post-traumatic stress without seeing combat?
Of course you can. I mean, we have people in the United States who have post-traumatic stress. It's estimated that 8% of the population in the United States will suffer post-traumatic stress at some time. So we're
talking about Ivan Lopez, certainly as the shooter. Should he be viewed as a wounded warrior?
I think you have to. If you really want to get the stigma associated with these problems, we have got to consider these wounds of war, when, in fact, a large majority of those we're seeing in the service today have served and served on multiple tours.
Nick Schmidle, you wrote about Chris Kyle, the so-called American sniper who was killed by, allegedly by another veteran who was very troubled. He saw no combat. What lessons do you take from this and your time spent covering that Chris Kyle story?
A couple of things. I mean, I think that it's impossible to know, as General Chiarelli was mentioning, exactly what everyone is going through. You can't get into someone else's mind. You can't understand what factors tripped them to commit whatever acts. The second thing, though, is that, you know, these wars are coming to an end, and yet the effects of these wars on the men and women who served perhaps will be seen for decades to come. And I think that that's something that the American public thinks that, okay, there were no casualties in Iraq and Afghanistan during the month of March. The American commitment is over, and it's far from over.
But I want to read something from your piece by Phil Carter. You quote Phil Carter, who we just saw in my piece. "This after war is just beginning," said Carter. He compared this period to the one following Vietnam. As Vietnam was winding down, demand for mental health services went up, homelessness went up. That's when people transition. That's when symptoms occur or latent issues manifest, he said. War has a long tail.
All right.
What do we owe our service members?
Well, I mean, I think that's it would be horrific to imagine that you would send a young man or woman into Iraq or Afghanistan at the worst time of combat, ill-equipped for war. We would be horrified by that idea. And yet there is a compact, I think, between those who fought and this country. And so we should be equally as horrified that they're ill-equipped to come home and transition home as we were that they were ill-equipped to fight.
Congressman Carter, you've seen this happen twice now at
Yes.
Fort Hood. The lessons that he's talking about, and General Chiarelli as well, what are you seeing?
I absolutely agree. And General Chiarelli and I have talked about this in the past. The issue of the mental health of our service members is critical. And we've got two issues that come up in everything, is why and what can we do. And what can we do is we have to provide more resources both at the DOD level and at the VA level. And that transition needs to be smooth. Because Pete's right. You can have post-traumatic stress in any ordinary job. It depends on the level of stress you can carry. Some can carry tons, others can carry none.
But this soldier was receiving treatment.
Well, that's an excellent point. And the point I would like to make is the fact that we have lots of soldiers receiving treatment, and just because we get them into treatment doesn't mean that we're going to be able to take care of the problem they have, because we just don't know enough. We don't know enough about post-traumatic stress. We don't know enough about traumatic brain injury. We need to mount a national effort to get at this problem and ensure that we do our research a lot smarter than we've done in the past.
And a lot of it's self-reporting. If he didn't report any violent outbursts before, then his mental health workers wouldn't know, correct, Congressman?
That's correct. But we've had that. We started working on that issue way back in 04 as to convincing soldiers to report their injuries, including their bad dreams, sleeplessness, fits of terror, or whatever. They felt it showed weakness. They were strong soldiers, and it kind of weakened their image. And it was a real fight, and the hierarchy in the Army did a real strong effort to get it done. And I think it's better. Don't you, General Chiarelli? I think so. It's better. I think they're stepping up now and saying, I got problems. You can't start without identifying your problem, and it can't be a pariah to identify.
Just very quickly, Nick, as more troops come home, do you expect more problems?
Inevitably, but they don't have to all be violent. I mean, there are just problems adjusting. And I think that the big issue as well is just individuals falling through the cracks, individuals coming back and having symptoms that don't quite register, that don't qualify them for long-term programs, but that do qualify them for attention. They don't get it, and this is what happened in the Chris Kyle story as well.
And again, everyone with mental health issues is not prone to violence. We want to make that point. Thank you so much for joining us today, gentlemen. A great conversation.